With the Maharlika Investment Corporation lineup now almost complete, our first guest will now weigh in on the personalities leading the team and talk about what he thinks are the crucial first steps to getting the fund right. Alex Escucha finally joins us live on the show. Good to speak with you, Alex. Good morning.
Thank you for having me. Good morning, Mimi.
All right. So you've got an ADB veteran with stints at Steel Asia and Maybank. You've also got an ex-director of the Capital Markets Integrity Corporation. Another one is an intra-corporate dispute litigator who specializes in hostile corporate takeovers, and an executive of a government media outlet and other companies, including Converge ICT. This lineup looked promising. The four names of directors have been released. They've been sworn in. Do you personally know any of them? What are your thoughts on the lineup? Good choice? Good pick?
In general, they are good choices. As our friend Stevie Kuan-Yeng emphasized, the important thing about the Maharlika board is it should represent a diversity of backgrounds and solid track records. And I think this group has it. As I was thinking about it, out of the nine directors of the board, really six will be doing the heavy lifting, so to say. The chair, Secretary of Finance, basically will not have the time to go into the details. The presidents of Land Bank and DBP are directors, but they will be very busy with their own day jobs. So the real heavy lifting, so to say, of the boards of the board will be the president and two regular directors and the three independent directors. So Manny Reyes founded the Reyes Takandong office, and he is of course an accountant auditor. He would be ideal to be chair of the audit committee. Andrew Gan is a banker. He would be a good chair of the risk management committee. And Bita Lichauco is a lawyer and would be a good head of the governance related party transactions committee or the compliance committee. There is Vicky is a very has a very good all around background. She is a fellow member with the Foundation for Economic Freedom, and she would be very well matched with either the investment committee or the remuneration committee. The last slot for regular director would ideally have a very, very strong background also in project finance. Because as I discussed in my, as you know, I have written four columns already in the business world on Maharlika. And in part two, I mentioned that there is one committee that is not mentioned in the law or even mentioned in the IRR, but is very, very important. This is the investment committee, because as practiced globally, in the other investment infrastructure funds, the composition of the investment committee, as well as the composition of the team that is doing the staff work for screening all of this investment, is one of the most scrutinized building blocks of the fund that fellow partners, like fellow strategic investment funds, fellow pension funds, and other private investors will be looking at, because whether they have the skill set, the domain knowledge, the track record to be able to screen projects over and above the screening process already done by the NEDA board.
All right. And this last slot remains open. Do you have a name that you've been hearing going around in circles? Do you have a personality in mind that you think fits the bill?
I have no idea. And I will to guess, but I have every confidence that the right choice will be made, and that whoever is appointed will take this job seriously. I'm reminded of the comment by the CEO of the Norwegian Investment Bank, which manages the Norwegian Global Pension Fund, when he started a speech with saying that he received a letter from a 10-year-old girl sending him 2 kroner coins and said, "Nikolai, please take care of my money." And he said, "That is why I take my job seriously." Mm-hmm. I fully expect that the entire board, especially President Joel Consing, will take their job seriously. And he also takes seriously the earlier pronouncement of President Marcos when he said, it should be run professionally because mixing politics into this mix will definitely make it a failure.
Mm-hmm. Alex, just very quickly, I remember, and a common friend, Stephen Kunyang, he always said this, the fund, it sounds like it's everything, everyone, all at once. There are still so many loopholes and flaws in the law and the IIR. But what do you think are some of the first key steps? You know, no fund is perfect, but what would you suggest are the first critical steps that the leadership should get right to start this fund on the right path? What should be the first order of business?
I think the first two steps have already been taken. Mm-hmm. Number one, of course, elect the right president, CEO.
Okay.
So this came very fast. In the Indian Infrastructure Fund example, it took them 1 year of a very transparent process to do an executive search for their CEO. Mm-hmm. I think we have the right one already. Okay. Step two is the right mix of the board of directors with the proper qualifications.
All right. What's next? And
the next would be form the charters of the committees very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And this would be, and in my second part two, I mentioned again, there are key foundational committees, which even if they are not written in the law, 11954, or the IRR, the Maharlika board has the inherent powers to create them. So these are the investment committee.
Mm-hmm. Which is critical.
Yeah. And the related party transactions committee, which is a very important party to sort of be transparent about potential related conflicts of interest. Hmm. In the case of Indonesian investment fund, they have an ethics committee at the oversight board, meaning there is an oversight board over and above the regular board. And their ethics committee is at the oversight board, which is consisting of ministerial level officer. So I think the RPP, which is actually a best practice concept already at the SEC and the BSP level, is something that should be a given.
Mm-hmm.
Because as in my last column that came out yesterday in the lesson of the Chinese leverage fund, the CIC, for example, came out with they signed up immediately for the Santiago principles, meaning they were committing already to the principles of accountability, professionalism, transparency, disclosure, and accountability.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the key steps. So whatever building blocks that will lead to this would send a very strong signal to the investment community that we are serious about getting this right.
So serious to get it right that the finance secretary says, you know, you cannot just call out the funds from DBP or Land Bank. The money should be in the bag already, even before we select which projects to invest in. Alex, you made several comparisons earlier, the India Infrastructure Fund, and the most recently is China's experience with its so-called sovereign leveraged fund. So you compared us and say there might even be lessons from China's own experience. Can you share with us what those lessons could be? I mean, what's the difference between the fund that we have and the so-called sovereign leveraged fund? And what are some of the similarities, especially in lessons we can draw from them?
Thank you. The number one lesson, I think, which needs clarification again and again, mm-hmm. is that most people think still we don't need this Maharlika fund because we don't have a surplus. The World Bank reports that there are 120 funds all over the world, of which 40 are strategic investment funds. Wealth funds are funded from surplus, oil surplus mostly. In the case of Botswana, it's diamonds. In the case of Chile, it's copper. In the case of Singapore, South Korea, and China, because of their consistent export surpluses. On the other hand, Indonesia, which is the most recent one, is based on scarcity. In fact, there are more than a dozen funds created during the pandemic time, and this is documented by the World Bank, that was created precisely to address the scarcity issues arising from the COVID pandemic. Mm-hmm. So to recap, there are a wealth fund is different from a strategic investment fund or strategic development fund. Mm-hmm. The wealth fund, just like Norway, invests mostly abroad. They do not invest in Norway itself. In a strategic investment or development fund, it is focused internally, mainly in infrastructure, precisely to help in the development of the country.
Mm-hmm. And what we're having is the Strategic Investment Development Fund.
Yes.
And that is clear.
That should be, in any discussion, that should be the starting point of everything, because I understand there's a lot of misconception, even among the proponents and the opponents.
I was going to say.
What kind of a financial economic animal is this? I think we need to get that right from the very first, and then build from there.
Mm-hmm. In your article, you also talked about, you know, despite starting out as a passive investor, the fund can eventually grow and evolve to be a strategic and active shareholder. Can you expound on that some more?
Well, that's one of the very good lessons in China, and even across all over the world. In fact, even the Middle Eastern funds have evolved and become more sophisticated. Their phase one is that they were just passive people. It's like, you know, it's like a client of a private banking or a trust fund where, okay, I have money. I leave it to you to invest it because I believe you can get more yields, better returns than I could if I were to do it myself. Mm-hmm. That's the passive investor. Later, they're now into, let's select the right kind of, it's like even in the trust fund, you have a directed investment, meaning the investor has more say in which assets or which sectors to go into. Mm. In phase three, the more we have seen in the last 20 years, like the California Teachers Fund, like CalPERS, where they are really activist stakeholders, where they really vote or even try to vote out management of certain companies that they invest in, which are not aligned with their values or with their directions. I think we're not yet there. That should be stage four. But in the case of the other investment funds, and even in China, they are now, they have what they call the combination of state power, meaning directing an industry or the economy via legislation or via administrative directives, and market power, meaning if you're a major or significant shareholder in a company, you can change the direction of that company from the board itself. And a good example of this is if you are a shareholder in a company, as a shareholder, you can sort of add to the push towards ESG, the environment, social, and governance directives towards aligning with the SDG goals of the UN, for example.
Mm-hmm. That's a pretty interesting timeline that you showed, how the fund and its people and its leaders can actually evolve over the years. Hopefully we can advance to the next stages sooner rather than later, but it takes time because no fund is perfect. It's gonna be trial and error, I imagine, at first. Plus, it doesn't work in a vacuum. All the fund's performance is gonna be based on the environment it's in as well. So, Alex, I wanna end with this. You know, but hopes are high. Take, yes, go ahead.
If I may say, we are one of the last actually to do this. There are so many who have done it ahead of us, and so many have learned, have made the mistakes and learned the lessons. In short, they have paid the tuition fee. So we don't have to pay the tuition fee ourselves. Just look at what they did right, and what they did wrong, and take it from there.
Mm-hmm. All right. So speaking of expectations, the bar is high. You know, despite all the questions, I know everyone is excited to see how this fund will perform, how it will move. So I guess I want to end with this. What is a realistic expectation? Given the kind of environment we're in, how shallow, how young, how small our market, our local market is, the struggles that we have in raising funds for that much needed infrastructure, the interest we get from foreign investors. I know the fund is supposed to attract foreign investors to put money into the country as well. And of course, the kind of market conditions we're looking at, higher for longer rate environment, slowing macroeconomic growth. You know, at the start of this year, everybody was saying 2024 is gonna be party time for all of us. Things are gonna get better. But now we're seeing diverging expectations. Some saying, you know, next year is when the real pain hits, when you realize how growth is going to slow. So what do you think is a real expectation? So I know the fund is saying it's looking at an 8% return annual. Is that realistic? Or is it time to temper the expectations?
I have two quick phrases for that. Number one is long-term view. And number two is process. When you say long-term view, if you're talking of the infrastructure projects, you're talking of projects which have 10, 15, 25 years gestation periods. And in the case of Norway, it is said even that their investment horizons are up to 100 years, meaning across generation, across political terms. And that has to be established from the very start. The second is process. As you know, I am my strength and forte is in the governance aspect. And the governance aspect is very much focused on putting the right processes, putting the right elements in place and in the proper sequence. I'm reminded of my former boss who said when he was talking to me about a project, I may not agree with the results that you give to me, but if you assure me that number one, you have the right parameters, you have the right weights, and you observe the protocol processes in a very transparent way, then I can live with the results. I think from what I have read and seen in the other sovereign funds, that is the number one element. It's not hyping up the expectations, but a very solid way that to show them that we have the right organization, that we have the right pieces, that we have the right people, both at the board and even at the staff level. Because in the case of the European Infrastructure Fund, the foreign investors were looking at two things. One is the individual qualifications of the CEO and the board members, but they actually were looking at the second level. What is the track record of this set of people working together? That's why even in the Irish Fund, that was part of the lessons that they were documenting, that the signaling of this is very much key to establishing credibility. Mm-hmm. And once you have that, you will attract the foreign investors, you will attract the private investors, because they know that the processes are in place, and transparency is very much a big part of that.
All right, Alex, there's nothing else I can add. Thank you so much for joining us. Long-term view, It's all about the process. Alex Escucha, thank you for joining us for the Insights. What a way to end the week. I know a lot of people are watching this fund. We're all hoping for the best. Thank you for joining us again. Happy weekend and happy holidays.
Thank you very much. Have a blessed Christmas.
All right.